Good afternoon, student friends. Let us continue with the shear strength of soils. In the previous classes, we have been discussing about the concept of shear strength. Shear strength required for soils. Okay, the Mohr column theory, and how it is realized in the laboratory for finding out the shear strength parameters. Then we saw how these can be plotted and what are the parameters obtained from the plot of shear stress versus normal stress. We saw how the Mohr circle can be plotted for the test results, and also we saw how we can plot it in a conventional way, and also we can plot it in a modified way, that is to get the modified failure envelope. We can also plot in terms of total stress and also in terms of effective stress to get the respective parameters. We also saw what is the what are drainage conditions and how they are realized in the laboratory. These are done to simulate to the field conditions. We saw the various laboratory testing procedures, namely the direct shear test, we saw the triaxial shear test, and also before that we saw the unconfined compression test. We in this today's class will also discuss about the vane shear test, which is not completely covered, and we saw how to work out numerical examples. We also looked into the various questions which are appeared in the VTU question papers. We saw how to solve some problems, numerical examples on direct shear test. We will continue today. We have not discussed about the sensitivity and thixotropy, and we have to work out some problems on the shear strength parameters to obtain from the triaxial testing. Now we will continue. See, two formulas which I told you, we have to remember. This is the two formulas which are very simple and very essential to remember if you want to work out any numerical example. And this, okay, there is a missing here, this should be fine. Now let us look into the formula. So one is the Mohr column equation. We have seen the famous equation tau is equal to modeling of soil, tau is equal to C plus sigma tan phi. Now this C is called the cohesion intercept, and the sigma n is the normal stress, and phi is the angle of internal friction, tan of the tan. See. Now we have seen other relationship, tau is equal to there is a mistake, sigma 1, okay. I will write it on the board because of some. This is the two equations which have to be remembered, and one is tau is equal to C plus sigma and tan phi, and sigma 1 is equal to sigma 3 tan square alpha plus 2 C. Is a mistake in this topographical error. Now let us get into the let us solve some numerical examples. See, in the previous class we had worked out some portion of this numerical example. We saw how in a direct shear test we could find out the from the normal stress and shear stress of two identical samples which are tested, and they are subjected to failure, and we got the shear parameters. Now what would be the deviator stress at failure if a triaxial test is carried out on the same soil with the same with a cell pressure of 150 kilonewton per meter square. This has appeared in the university paper VTU January-February 2005, the new scheme 10 marks, recent 5 years back. Now how to solve this problem? In the took the direct shear data, and we obtained the shear parameters. We use this equation tau is equal to C plus sigma and tan phi. So the two parameters are C and phi, which are to be evaluated. We obtained the values C is equal to 90 kPa, then we obtained phi is equal to 5.71 degrees. Now with this data, he is asking in a, if the same identical specimen is tested in a direct shear, this in triaxial test, shear test, what would be the deviated stress and failure. Means when a specimen is tested, what is the additional stress sigma d? This is called the deviated stress. In addition to the all round cell pressure, which is sigma 3, this plus this is sigma 1. We have got the all round pressure sigma 3. This he has given sigma 3 is 150 kilonewton per meter square. Now, what is this value? Now, how to obtain this? Now, I know this equation, the relationship between principal stress and failure, sigma 1 is equal to sigma 3 is 150 tan square of alpha, alpha is equal to 45 degrees plus 5 by 2. Now, if I substitute that value of alpha, I obtained tan alpha is equal to 47.86. Plus 2 into C is 90 into tan of 47.86, this should be tan square. Okay. Now, I obtain a value of sigma 1 is equal to 382.14 kilonewton per meter square. Now, what is this sigma 1? This is the major principal stress, which is the summation of the deviated stress plus the cell pressure or the minor principal stress. Now, sigma 1 is equal to sigma 3 plus sigma d, which is equal to 382.14. From this, I know what is sigma 3. Therefore, sigma d is equal to 382.14 minus 150, which is the cell pressure. Therefore, I obtain a value of 232.14 kilonewton per meter square. This is the deviated stress. Means the additional stress required to shear off the sample at an angle equal to this is alpha. Now let us look into the next problem. I hope you are clear with how to use these two equations. I used only these two. See, first in the direct shear test, I used this equation, I obtained these parameters. In the second part, I used this. Therefore, analytically, very conveniently, these two equations are very useful for finding out the required parameters. Now, let us look into this numerical example. In this is asking, the test is done on a sample in a trial test, the conditions are undrained test, and he is telling the samples are identical clay samples, the readings were recorded, the cell pressure is 50 kPa, then the deviated stress was 350, the pore pressures. See here he has recorded the pore pressure, measurements are done. Usually in a undrained test, you try to record, especially in the consolidated undrained test, you try to record the pore water pressure. Now, these are the data with increase in the cell pressure, there is increase in the deviated stress, there is no chance for the pore water pressure which is developing to dissipate, it is building up, and with the increase in the cell pressure, the pore pressure is also increasing. You can see here 5, 10, 12 and 18, the deviated stress, additional stress required to fail is also increasing. They are right. Okay. And any time in the numerical examples, if there are any typographical errors, we can make out whether they are in a proper way. It's a common sense. You will have to look into the data. Plot the modified failure envelope and determine the values of the effective shear strength parameters. Now, what is to be done here is to, you need to prepare a table indicating how you are going to get effective parameters. You need to calculate. Now, I already explained to you in the previous classes what is meant by modified failure envelope. See, you it is not the effective stress envelope, it is the modified failure envelope. Now, since he is asking you to find out the effective shear parameters, now I need to find out C dash and phi dash. Now, and is also asking you to plot the modified failure envelope. Now, what is meant by modified failure envelope? You need to plot a graph of P versus, sorry, a PQ plot is to be plotted. Now what is P? P is equal to sigma 1 plus sigma 3 divided by 2, and Q is equal to sigma 1 minus sigma 3 divided by 2, the principal stress difference. Now, since he is asking you to evaluate the effective shear strength parameters, I need to take P dash and Q dash. Therefore, all these parameters are going to be with primes. Now, I need sigma 1 prime, sigma 3 prime, and also here sigma 1 and sigma 3 prime. Therefore, with the given data, he has given the cell pressure, he has given the deviatoric stress, he has given the pore outer pressure. You need to look into how you can tabulate these results. I will show you how to tabulate these results, and later we can plot it. Now, with the given data, see the sigma 3 values are given, sigma 3, then sigma d values are given, and pore outer pressures are given in kPa. Say for the first sample, second sample, and third sample, without wasting time, let us get into the numerical values. Again, you got the fourth one, 600. Now, the deviatoric stress is 350, then you got 440, 530, and 610. The pore outer pressure is 5, 10, 12, and 18. Now, to obtain sigma 1, okay, sigma 1 is equal to sigma 3 plus sigma d. I have to obtain first this value, sigma 3 plus sigma d. So, I will get value of 350 plus is 400, 440 plus is 540, then 530 plus 150 is 680, then you get 810. These are the things which are making the first calculation. I am just drawing a line so that you can differentiate between the given data and whatever you have calculated. Next, you are going to calculate sigma 1 prime. Okay, so let us calculate sigma 3 prime and sigma 1 prime. Now, sigma 3 prime is the difference between sigma 3 and pore outer pressure. 50 minus thing, you get 45, then you get 90, 100 minus is 10, 150 minus 12, you get 138, then you get 182. Then sigma 1 prime, to get the sigma 1 prime, sigma 1 minus of pore outer pressure, 400 minus this thing is 395, 540 minus 10 is 530, then you get 668, then you get 792. Simple difference between the major principal stress and the total stress minus of the pore outer pressure. Now, once I obtain these sigma 3 prime and sigma 1 prime, now I need to find out P dash. P dash is equal to sigma 1 prime plus sigma 3 prime divided by 2, the average of the summation. Then Q dash is equal to sigma 1 prime minus the principal stress, the average principal stress difference. Now, these values work out to be 220, 310, 403, 487, then you got 175, 220, 265, then 305. Now, these are the values which are required. These values are to be plotted as a graph, and I can, from the graph, it is very important, you need to have care to plot properly. Convert, you are not going to get the shear parameter C and phi, you are going to get D and D dash and psi dash. From that, you need to convert into the required parameters. Now, let us try to plot this graph. Now, the maximum value of P dash is 487, around 500. Let us take zero, 100, 200, 300, 400, 500. This is P dash, which is sigma 1 prime plus sigma 3 prime divided by 2. Then we have got on the y axis, we should have the same scale. This is very essential. You got a maximum value of 305, therefore, it is enough, you can take up to 400. Now, for the first point, 220, 175, it comes from here, 220, this first point is coming here. Then you got 310, for 310, it is 220, you get a point here, somewhere here. Then the third one is 403 and 265. Then you get the fourth one, 487 somewhere here. Then you got 305 somewhere here. Now you join these points by a best fit and extend it backwards. Okay, I can extend it backwards. So this is the modified failure envelope. Now I have got this intercept. This is known as D, because this is a modified envelope in terms of the effective shear parameters. Therefore, effective stresses. Therefore, it is D dash, and the slope that I am going to get here is psi. Since I am using effective stresses, it is going to be psi dash. Now I need what is required? I need C dash and phi dash. Therefore, I know the relationship between phi and psi. Therefore, sin phi is equal to tan psi. Now, since it is effective, this becomes phi dash, or in other words, phi dash is equal to sin inverse of tan psi. We get the value. Then I know C is equal to D by cos phi. Whatever value you are going to get, you are going to use here, since this is effective. I am going to write this prime, I am going to just get this value. I do not have the values. One can with a simple thing, you can find out. It is something in around 80, you are going to get psi is equal to 35 or 38. You can get the value of shear parameters. So, it is very clear how we can see, we are directly getting the points. Instead of drawing the Mohr circle, we can convert into your points, stress points. Okay, it is called the stress variance. Now, we will get into the varieties of problems on this. I brought some interesting problems for your understanding. Now, we will get into this. Undrained triaxial compression test was conducted on a clay cell. The following results are recorded. Determine the total stress parameter and the effective stress parameter. Similar to what we did in the previous thing, we need to make a tabular column. So, you got the pore water pressure, you need to sum up this. There is no deviator stress, directly is given the total the principal stress sigma 1. Just sigma 1 minus of u gives your sigma 1 prime, and sigma 3 17 minus 12 we get your the effective cell pressure or the minor principal stress. Like this, you can make a tabular column, plot the graph of total stress versus you can plot the Mohr circle. For total stresses, you get the failure based on the total stresses. If you work based on the effective stresses, you get the thing. You need to, it is a simple problem similar to what we did in the previous system. Now, let us look into this numerical example. See, the previous one can also be solved analytically. See, I can give you some principal stress difference, how we are going to get this values. See, I got this sigma 1 prime is equal to sigma 1 minus of u, and you got sigma 3 prime is equal to sigma 3 minus u. I will give the values of the for the three trials. We are going to get for the first one, second one and third one, we can solve it very quickly analytically. Sigma 1 is 145, for the second one it is 184, then it is 203, this is 5, 24 and 34. Now, you know what is sigma 1 and sigma 3 in terms of total stresses. Okay, now we can plot, either we can plot it or we can try to work out using the, based on the total stress parameters, total stress values, I will use the relationship between sigma 1 and sigma 3 relationship, that is relationship between the principal stresses and failure, because these samples values are recorded at the failure value. Therefore, sigma 1 is equal to sigma 3 tan square alpha plus 2 c tan alpha. Now, I know sigma 1, I know sigma 3. This is unknown, this is unknown. I can form equations, simultaneous equations. 157 is equal to 17 into tan square alpha plus 2 c tan alpha. I call this as equation 1. The second equation is 204 is equal to 44 into tan square alpha plus 2 c tan alpha. So, I can form one more equation, because I got the third sample, 225 is equal to 56 into tan square alpha . I can use any two equations. I can use these two equations, I can use these two equations, or you can use third and the first equation. You can solve simultaneously. See, there are two equations, two unknowns. I got alpha and c. Therefore, solving simultaneously, solving 1 and 2, I have got alpha is equal to 52 degrees 0.84, therefore phi is equal to 15.68 degrees. Then if you substitute, you get c is equal to 48.3 kilonewton per meter square. The same thing, if I solve it using the total effective stresses, let us see how we can get based on the effective stresses. This becomes sigma 1 prime is equal to sigma 3 prime into tan square alpha prime plus 2 c dash into dash. Now, when I substitute in the similar way, I got this tabular column. 145 is equal to the sigma 3 is 5 into tan square alpha dash plus 2 c dash into tan alpha dash. Similarly, the next one is 184. I got this 184. This is 24 into tan square alpha plus 2 c dash into tan alpha. I can form one more equation. 203 is equal to 34 into . Now in this one may get a doubt. See, one can substitute in this equation, in the third equation, if you substitute these values, you should get both should match, it will definitely match. Now, if you solve this equation, this is 4, this is 5 and this is 6. Now, solving these two or any two equations, we get phi dash is equal to 20.18, c dash is equal to 47 kPa. So, these are the, now look here, based on the total stress, the phi value will be, the slope is less, based on the effective stress, the slope is more. Therefore, your answers are right. And also, you can look here, what happens when the slope gets changed, the intercept gets changed. Now, let me qualitatively draw this diagram. If I try to plot a graph like this, if I try to plot this and get a Mohr circle, I will be getting, based on the total stress, it will be like this. Okay, based on the effect of stress, it will be. Yes. So this is phi dash. This is phi. You got this as C. This will be C dash. Okay, therefore, you can see here how the slope changes and how the intercept changes. They are very marginal, but still, this is how the it looks. Now let us get into the next problem. This is I think we have done this. Okay, now we will get into the a cylindrical specimen of a saturated soil fails under an axial stress of 115. This is a unconfined compression test. This is a very simple test wherein is given. Look into the data. If you look here, he has given it's an unconfined compression test, UCC test. Now the axial stress is in the axial direction. When it is compressed, you get a failure stress of 150 axial stress of 150 kilo Newton per meter square in a unconfined compression test. The failure plane makes an angle of 52 degrees. Calculate the cohesion and angle of internal friction. So when you do a unconfined compression test, basically you got your deviator stress. Okay, since you don't have the sigma 3 which is 0, therefore this will be your sigma 1. Okay, now you don't have this confinement, sigma 3 is 0. Okay, whatever axial stress you get. Okay, now this is your axial stress, which is 150 kilo Newton per meter square, which is nothing but your QU value, the undrained strength value, unconfined compression test value, or UCC compressing test value. Now, based on this, the sample has failed at an angle of alpha. The alpha is given as 52 degrees. Now, what is this angle alpha? Alpha is equal to 45 degrees plus 5/2. Now, since in a unconfined compression test, the values, the parameters will be in undrained conditions, you will get undrained parameters. Therefore, from this, phi u is equal to how much? You get to 52 minus 45 is 7, 7 into 2 is 14 degrees. Okay, this is the phi u value. If I substitute in the relationship, sigma 1 is equal to sigma 3 tan square alpha plus 2 c tan alpha. See, this becomes 0, your sigma 1 is 150. So 2 into Cu into tan alpha, alpha is 52 degrees, you get Cu is equal to 150 means it is 75 divided by tan of 52, we will get something slightly less than 73 or 75, because tan 45 is 1, it is slightly more than 1, okay, we will be getting slightly less than 1. This is how you can solve the numerical examples on undrained missing. Now, let us look into some theory questions which are asked in the pore pressure. Based on this, I am going to teach you a problem how, from the practical point of view, how you sample this soil and how it is transferred to the laboratory, how it is tested, how you are going to realize the field conditions in the laboratory. Now, here is asking what is the what do you mean by pore water pressure, and he is asking you to differentiate between positive pore water pressure and negative pore water pressure, indicating practical significance. Now, let us look into the problems and try to come back to this question. So, now this is some of the beautiful colorful photos about the digital triaxial testing with pore pressure measuring devices. This is an electronic conversion kit with all this transducers and this connecting kit. Okay, it is a very beautiful connecting devices. Now, based on this, let us try to see. So, what happens? When does this pore water pressure come into picture? So, whenever you try to load it, okay, you will have the water present in a saturated condition. If it is there, that pressure will be taken by pore water. If it doesn't have chance to get dissipated, it will be showing as a pore water pressure. Now, let us look into this very interesting numerical example. He is telling here in this problem, a sample of saturated clay is obtained from the field. in the field condition, what is happening is taking without causing any disturbance and without allowing its water content to change, means it is a undisturbed sample. In the field, the sample was subjected to the following stresses. What are the stresses? The total stress is 250 kPa, and you got the pore water pressure. There is some pore water pressure. It is in a it's a clay sample, saturated sample. It has got some pore water pressure, and you got the effective stress, the difference sigma minus of u. What is effective stress? Effective stress is equal to total stress minus of pore water pressure. Now we know this relationship. Effective stress is equal to total stress minus of u. Now we have obtained that value, it is there. Now next, further is telling, the sample was placed in a triaxial cell and a cell pressure of 100 kPa was applied to the sample. Okay, now he is trying to realize something which is there. See, effectively you got a field stress of 100 kPa, he is trying to put back. Now what are the total stress, pore water pressure and the effectors acting on it? Okay, then next is asking, the cell pressure was raised to 300 kPa. So first it was 100 kPa, then it has been increased to 300 kPa. The drainage valve was kept closed in that condition. Now what are the values of the total stress, pore water pressure and the effective stress acting on it? Next is asking, the drainage valve was opened and complete consolidation was allowed to occur. Then what happens is asking, what is the state of the stresses, total stress, pore water pressure and effective stress. Then is asking, has the sample's water content changed? If so, has it increased or decreased? Then is asking about the degree of saturation of the sample, whether it has changed or remained same. If it is so, has it increased or decreased? Then finally, the drainage valve is closed and additional axial stress is applied and the cell pressure is constant. Okay, pore water pressure was measured to be equal to 70 kPa when additional axial stress of 100 kPa was applied. What is the A factor? You got this Compton's factor, which indicates about the state of the soil, whether it is normally consolidated or pre-consolidated, whether it is highly pre-consolidated or it is in a normally with a less pre-consolidation pressure. Now, when the additional stress was 200 kPa, what is the A factor? Now, and what is the A factor at failure when you apply an additional stress of 200 kPa? Okay, and is also asking, what is the effective stress, major principal stress at failure? Now let us look into the field conditions. Now what happens actually in the field? See, we will have this sample. Look here, the sample, it has been subjected to vertical stress, there is some lateral confinement pressure. Okay, this is a representative sample. Now it may be undisturbed sample. Now when I try to load it, okay, when I try to load it, I will be loading to failure, okay, or I am loading to its bearing capacity value. What happens to this soil behavior? What is the bearing capacity? I understand this. What we do when you try to bring it to the laboratory, we try to simulate to the field conditions. Now what we do, we try to either do by a triaxial test or a direction test. These are the slides which I showed you earlier. Now in this context, we understood. Now again, coming back to how to simulate to the field conditions in the laboratory. Now see here, you got a sample which is there, which is undisturbed sample is there. We try to extrude the sample, we try to get into a split mold, we try to sample that and trim it to the required size, we extract that sample, we place it on a triaxial pedestal, we try to use the rubber membrane. Now we try to apply the cell water and try to apply the cell pressure, and we, this is how it is placed inside the triaxial cell. Then we have got all the accessories, we placed in the proper condition. Then we try to do the shear test by realizing the drainage conditions and the sample is filled. This is how we try to do it. Now let us look into the problem. See, having understood how it is done from the laboratory, from the field to the laboratory, now let us get into this problem. So this is a field condition. We have got this field stresses 250 kPa as the total stress, and you got the 150 kPa as the pore water pressure, and the effective stress is 100 kPa. Now when you try to sample it, what happens when you bring it to the laboratory? The in situ stress has been relieved, you do not have any total stress, it is only the pore water pressure. What happens? It is like when I suck something, you know, there is a negative pore water pressure. So when there is outside pressure, there is a positive pore water pressure. Now when I try to suck, see, whenever we try to drink any juice or something, we use a straw and try to suck the fluid against gravity. That is, you are trying to create suction. Similar thing, when the sample, when it has been subjected to all round stress, when you try to remove that sample from the in situ condition, the total stress goes away. The whatever inside the pores or the voids, there is a negative pressure. That is what is happening here. When the total stress becomes zero, your negative pressure is going to take place, because what is your pressure in the laboratory? Pore water pressure is, that is going to be 100. How it is 100? Because at the point to point contact, we had a stress of 100 kPa, which was a point to point contact, it was 100 kPa. Now it becomes in the reverse direction, it will be trying to hold back in the reverse direction. Okay, that is therefore the pressure will be. Now we can try to work out this. Okay, your effective stress is in the initial condition, what is the effective stress? It is 100 kPa, this is 100 kPa, your total stress becomes 0, therefore what happens to your pore water pressure? U becomes minus 100 kPa. It is a very interesting problem. Okay, it is been given in book called Engineering Bureau of Soils, not Engineering Bureau of Soils, okay, Engineering Soil Mechanics or something. It is a book written by Shashi K. Gulati. It is a very fantastic book on shear strength. Now, let us look into the next stage. What happens in the cell, after placing into the cell, the in the initial stage, the cell pressure is 100 kPa. Now, we are getting effective stress of 100 kPa. Now, what is to be done here? We have to work out how to get the. Now, after applying the cell pressure of 100 kPa, when I apply the cell pressure of sigma 3 is equal to 100, now your pressure comes to what is the total stress? Okay, now it becomes 100 minus 100 0, total stress becomes 0. Then the next stage, what happens? You are increasing this to sigma 3 to 300 kPa. When this becomes 300 kPa, what happens to your total stress? Your total stress will be 300 kPa. You got your pore water pressure, which is actually minus 100. Now, if you add another 300, it becomes 200 kPa. Then you get your effective stress is equal to this minus this, that is 300 minus 200, we get 100 kPa. This is how we get here in the second. Now, he is asking, when the drainage valve is opened, what happens? All this pore water pressure gets dissipated, your pore water pressure becomes 0. Therefore, in that stage, in the this thing, this will be 300 kPa. All the pressure will be transferred to the soil. Then your effective stress, which is 100, this will be transferred to the soil. It becomes 300 kPa. Sorry, it is 300 kPa. Next, he is asking whether the water content has definitely, when the water drainage valve is opened, it gets squeezed out. The pressure is there, it tries to come out through the valve. Then ultimately, what is the saturation, change in saturation? It is a saturated sample. Water can get reduced. Saturation will never change because it is in a saturated condition. Again, it will be saturated because the voids are completely filled with water. Saturation level is not going to change. Finally, he is asking, what is the A factor? A is equal to delta U by delta sigma D. Here in this case, it is 70 kPa. At that stage of the deviator stress was applied as 100. Therefore, your A value is 0.7. Then at failure, he further increases this deviator stress to failure. He is asking what is this value. Therefore, your AF is equal to 1. Therefore, what is your, from this you can find out what is sigma U. Sigma U is equal to, which is equal to 200. Okay, this is 200 kPa. Therefore, you get a value of 200 kPa. Then your sigma 1 is equal to sigma 3 plus sigma D. If you substitute, you get 300 is your total stress, sigma 3, then your deviator stress is 200, you get 500 kPa. Now, what is the, finally, what is the effective stress at failure? You got the total stress as 500, your pore water pressure is 200, therefore, you get 300 kPa. This is how we can solve the problems. Now, regarding the laboratory vein shear test, we got this laboratory vein shear test. You can see here how the vein is there and how it is placed into the soft sample. Actually, usually we are going to use a circular thing sample. Here it is someone tested, a square sample is being tested. Now, we got some, these are all the field tests. Okay. Now, I am going to discuss about the vein shear test combined with the field vein shear and the laboratory vein shear are similar, only we, the difference is the size. Now, this is suitable for soft to shift stiff clays. Now, you got these veins, you can see here the veins are there, you got the veins here. You can see the veins come with the diameter, so this is the diameter and this is the height. Okay. Now, if you try to look into the schematic, how it looks, okay, you are going to, through the torque rod, you are going to apply the torque and you are going to shear the specimen. How it is actually done? Okay, you are going to get the circumferential shear plus the shear at the top and bottom. Now, this is how it is done in the borehole. It is inserted inside the borehole and you are going to apply the torque and you are going to shear the specimen. See now how you can see here how it is getting sheared. Then you are going to have a rupture surface. Initially the soil offers certain resistance and slowly it gets remolded and then it offers very less resistance. You are going to record. See this test is done at a very slow rate, okay, 6 degrees to 12 degrees per minute. Okay, that is the rotation angular value. Then it can be done at every 1 meter. Now look here. How you are going to get your lateral stresses and you have got the top shear stresses. Now, I am rushing through because I need to get the final look here. How you got the edge stresses plus the shearing stresses at the surface shaft resistance. Now, final value is U is equal to torque value, whatever is recorded, you know the diameter, the dimension height is known, we can get your undrained shear strength. This is basically used for knowing the sensitivity of soils. Okay, you got the peak shear strength by the ultimate shear strength. Means peak shear strength is the in the undisturbed condition and the ultimate shear strength is in the remoted condition. So, now what are the facts that are to be remembered? Now, it is going to reduce the strength and you are going to get the undrained strength. It is therefore, it is a function of the angular rotation of the vein. Now, what are the corrections to be done? Barham has suggested correction, some lambda value. Lambda is given in terms of the cluster index, 1.7 minus 0.54 into log of cluster index. Now, the equations for finding out the undrained strength tau f or which is equal to Cu, if both the, you have got this, if this is the vein, you got this top portion and the bottom portion both participating, then you are going to get this equation. If only the bottom portion is going to participate and the top portion is convinced, you are not completely inserted, then you are going to use this equation. Accordingly, we can work out some problems. Here the numerical examples he has given, vein dimensions have been given. He is asking it, what is the torque applied at failure. He has given the undrained strength Cu, determine the torque which was applied. Okay, it is a simple thing, substitute in the equation, you get your value. Now, vein shear test conducted in another sample, another test, another numerical example where the test has been done on a, now look here, he has given in the undisturbed condition, in the remoted condition, we can find out based on this equation, the undisturbed condition, when I substitute in this equation, I get tau f is equal to Cu is equal to 329.98. Equation used is, because assuming that both the top and bottom are participating in the now when I use in the remoted condition I get tau f is equal to Cu is equal to I get a lesser value 13.35. now I am going to get a parameter which is called sensitivity. Sensitivity is equal to Cu in the undisturbed condition, in the remoted condition, if I substitute, I get this value as 2.47. Now, what is meant by this sensitivity? It is the ratio of the strength in the, these soils are very soft and they are useful, this soft soils are useful, the vein shear is useful in the finding out the sensitivity of soils in the soft condition. Now, what is meant by sensitivity? Sensitivity is the undrained strength, QU or CU, in the undisturbed to the remote condition. They are very useful in finding out the condition of the sample and disturbance. Now, based on the sensitive value, we have got this classification. You got insensitive values, you got normal to less sensitive, sensitive and extra sensitive and quick, greater than 16. So, some sensitive clays can have even up to 100, they will be very unstable. Look into the, see here, you got a sample which is very strong, so much load has been placed on disturbance. You can see here it has been poured into a fluid, okay. Many times it becomes quick and it flows in the X-ray diffraction. This is the scanning electron microscope view, how it looks. There is a lot of flocculated fabric. The consequence of sensitivity is that what happens, it is going to get disturbed, okay, then especially in pile driving in soft clays, it is going to therefore, it is inevitable, but what happens, there is one property called thixotropy. There will be a gain of this strength over a period of time, there will be a, because of the cementing agent being present in the soils and the at the molecular level at the same condition and same temperature, if it is left undisturbed, slowly it gains strength. Therefore, whenever you are doing pile driving in soft clays, we allow for 3 to 4 months some amount of the strength is regained. The thixotropy is from a Greek word meaning thixis means touch and tropion means change. Okay, on touching, what happens? On disturbing, the soil loses its strength. Thixotropy, an isothermal reversible time dependent process which occurs under constant composition and volume, thereby a material softens as a result of remolding and gradually returns to its original strength when allowed to rest. The larger the sensitivity, larger the thixotropic hardening. You can see here, there is a strength here, it gets on remolding, it comes to a residual value. You saw in the numerical example, if you allow it to stand, okay, it is hardening and it is building up the strength. Again, on remolding, it loses strength. This is called thixotropy. Now, reasons for the loss of strength, it is because there is a destruction of the structure and there may be orientation of the molecules in the adsorbed layers. Reason for the gain in strength with time, it is because of the rehabilitation of the molecular structure of the soil, and this is because of the thixotropic property of the material. Applications, in especially I told you, know, in pile driving, it is very, very useful. It because of the, see, the loss of, see, in clays what happens when there is a pile driving, the pore water pressures may be there because it is in saturated condition. It may build up the pore water pressures that may dissipate, okay. That is called consolidation, that is not thixotropy, because when consolidation takes place, the effective stress increases and there will be a build up of strength, okay. Consolidation is different from thixotropy, it is because of the cementation and aging, and you should differentiate. Now, you got this Torvane, the other filters, okay. You got this Torvane which is used for quick clays. And then you got the pocket penetrometer, which is, you can just do it in a pocket, you can just press, especially marine clays, they are useful. It is pushed in the, into the clay and try to, this is a pressure meter test, okay. You can just see here, it is a very beautiful thing. You got the pressure meter, we try to pressure the bore hole and try to, you can see here how it is pressured and you can find out the properties. This is the arrangement, you got the guard cells at the top and bottom and you got the measuring cell. We get the plot, when you do it, we get a plot of pressure versus time and volume expansion over time. We get this curve like this, pseudo elastic region and elastic region, we make the corrections. You got the static penetration test, static cone penetration test. This is how it is penetrated, and we try to find out the cone resistance and the tip resistance and the shaft resistance. Then these are useful for various soft clays to find out the friction ratio, whether we can know whether it is a sandy soil or a clay soil. Then finally, the standard penetration test, how we try to load it and we try to find out the summation of the load required to penetrate further of this seating drive of 15 centimeter, further 15 centimeter and further 15 centimeter, whatever values are there, n2 plus n3 is the n value. Now, the weight of this hammer is 63.5 kgs. Okay, this is the standard penetration test, SPT apparatus. Finally, partly saturated samples, you can see this beautiful figure I have shown you, how this was possible. This is not there in the syllabus. How this was possible? This was possible because of the presence of the apparent cohesion, which you can see here. You can see here more is the air pressure and this thing. You are going to have the C will be 0 when you got a saturated sample. When it is partly saturated, you get this moves over the line. Okay, you get this intercept. That is the apparent cohesion. But any questions you can please ask me. This is how this is possible. This pore water pressure. This is the apparent cohesion. You got any questions, please feel free to ask me. Thank you.